one. And you know what, I want to say this, that when I think about Proverbs and what we sometimes when we study in the morning, we say that the Old Testament is the shadow of that which is to come. And it is the shadow of one being in compliance with the Word of God. And I want you to say something, not only in the book of Ecclesiastes, in the book of Job, in the book of Proverbs, but as you read through the Bible, it's the shadow of that which is to come. And it is constantly revealing Christ in the new Bible. But it's also constantly revealing God's Word, one believing in God's Word, one being able to have perseverance at a time when God has spoken, when things don't look like what he is saying, which is faith. Everybody understand? And it's going on. And the reward. And my biggest thing is there is a reward when we begin to hear the Word of God, and like I like how he said it, and apply the knowledge of God in everyday living, in our everyday life. Because sometimes it's interesting, when we go into the New Testament, there are things that Christ is going to talk about, and we will see it in the New Testament like this: faith without, in the book of James will say like this: faith without works is dead. In other words, faith come by what? Hearing what? And James was saying, if we don't take that word and apply it, then there is no change. So when you, like what he said was powerful, but James kind of summed it up in a kind of a short. James said, let me put it like this. Faith come by hearing the word of God. And when we know that, when we think about Proverbs, Solomon, or those who wrote, they are being inspired by the Spirit of God, amen? Through life itself to give us life lessons. But but James says it so clearly. He says, well, faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. So when we hear the word of God, that's faith. But then he says, but faith without works is dead. So James is letting us know what we just went over by saying in the New Testament, if there is no application, applying the word of God, applying the knowledge in the word of God, then there is no reward. There is no change in life. There is not change just coming to church. There is not change just reading the Bible. What's funny is you could be introduced to change, but not, you could be introduced to something without receiving it and applying it. It just, your life stays the same. Amen? And that's why you may have some people say, well, I've been in church 14 years and I've been still, well, my question to you was, when you heard the word, what did you do with it? Because I like it when he was going over it, as he explained in Proverbs, but it's also a New Testament, the word of God touches every area of life. So the question is, in life, are we being led by the Spirit, the word of God? Or like God, what we were talking about, are we being led by our own thoughts and own feelings and emotions? Because one leads to life and the other leads to death. And sometimes it's hard to tell the difference, because when you're led by your own feelings and emotions, it can be good for a season. And you might get what you want. Some people are like, what? Yeah, because we know in Genesis, when the Bible says, make it perfectly clear, say anything that man would put his mind to it, he may be able to accomplish. But we're going to find out in Proverbs that accomplishing things the wrong way can still bring death to you. Meaning that you can accomplish it. You can get that man. You can get that money. But you can accomplish it outside of God. And therefore, because you lack the wisdom of God and you lack the knowledge of God that gives you the ability to what? Operate and function, you can't sustain it. So, and that's one thing I love about Proverbs, because especially the first one that we're going to read. Firstly, I think 1-9, a mother to the son, I think it's really powerful. And so we're going to go into the first. I just wanted to kind of go into that one to show you the connection between. Because sometimes when we go to Proverbs, what is the connection between that and the New Testament? Well, we see in the New Testament that Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Jesus connected your obedience to his word to love. How many of us got that? Jesus connected the obedience to the word of God reflected if you loved him or not. Okay. So let's start at Proverbs 1. Go ahead.
Proverbs chapter 1 verse 1, King James Version. The Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel. To know wisdom and instruction, to perceive the words of understanding, to receive the instruction of wisdom, justice, and judgment, and equity, to give subtlety to the simple, to the young man, knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear and will increase learning, and a man of understanding shall attain unto wise counsels. To understand a proverb and the interpretation, the words of the wise and their dark sayings.
I want us to break that down just for a moment. The only reason I want us to understand this, if you notice something that he read in those first couple of verses, are some of the biggest battles in the generation today. What I mean by that, if you look at some of the biggest battles in generation today, the Proverbs of Solomon says, knowing wisdom is instructions. We live in a society today that does not want what? Instructions. Everybody know. You can't instruct, no, I mean, you talking about in the society, oh man, you instruct somebody, get offended. You instruct somebody with something they feel like, you know, I got this. You instruct them about relationships. I got this. You instruct them about finance. I know this. It's like today we live in society is, in other words, I figure it out as I go. We keep reinvent. Wisdom seems to be eliminated because we live in society today that every generation, it's less, your kid, first you want to be, let's say I want to be rebellious. I got it, so I want to figure it out. Then I produce a kid who want to be rebellious, and they say they got it, and they figure it out. And then they produce a kid who say, I got this, want to rebuild. So you got a bunch of generation. And now let me tell you why I know what I'm saying is true. Because now we have generations that believe that rebellion with a child is natural behavior. They're just going through a bad. That's just what they go through. But that is only true when a child fails to want to receive instructions. Y'all, we better get there. Y'all better understand what I'm saying. In other words, this society that we are producing where it seems like you have to keep going over the same thing over and over again. And let me give an example. In relationships, like let's say we have a couple that we say, well, this is a good example. And then you'll have couples, they will not consult with that couple no matter what you say. They're going to say, I got this. And God don't deal. And then they say foolish stuff like God. Well, that is just because God ain't gonna deal with. God ain't gonna have to deal with me the same way He dealt with you. How many know principles are principles, regardless on which way you go. The principle to hold your peace can be given to anyone at any time, regardless of where you at in a relationship. But we create, and that's why. Watch this. I'm gonna tell you something. And that's why we have a society that has not grown spiritually. I believe also, and there are people, and I'm throwing it out there, and you can tell me what y'all think about it. That's why we have a society that we have to spend like the next 200 years just trying to go into grace. Trying to get them saved because they to live a life for God, they ain't even there yet. I just got to believe I'm saved first. Because it does not, and I'm trying to show you something, because when you lose things like you can't follow, when we don't want to hear instructions, when we don't want words of understanding, in other words, you don't want somebody to give you understanding of something, you got this. We're the society now that when we open up the book, when we open up a VCR, we are the society that take the instructions and throw them to the side. Because we think we know how it works. And therefore, it makes us a society that's not getting the full potential out of what we're doing. How many of you know if I throw the instructions to the side, I might get it to work, but I'm not going to get the full potential out of it? So we're a society is, I just want to get it to work. When I get with my boo, I just want it to get to work. I don't want it to reach its full potential. I'm just so glad to be married. I'm just so glad to got a boo. We the thirsty society. I'm just so glad I got a boo. I don't care how great it be. I'm just so glad I got money. I don't care what kind of legacy I leave. And that society ignores the understanding of wisdom and instructions. See, when we don't, I want to say this because this part right here, when I see this part right here, it's so powerful. I said this when I told you all this when I went to do the thing on Saturday. That we were talking about order in relationships. And I told the parent, it was some parents, and I said, how could you let, no parent should let not one of their sons and daughters date if they have never sat down and read the Bible? Because how are you going to let them date without instructions on how to make relationships work? How are you going to send them out there ill-equipped to deal with another? In this Bible, it tells you how to love souls. It tells you what the price is for a soul. And yet you're going to turn your child over to a soul who never read the manual. And then you wonder why your kid can't get the best outcome. Because we done told God when it comes to relationships, oh, I got this. And God be like, can you tell me where you got it from? Where's your reference point of wisdom? My mama and my daddy? We're going to learn about Proverbs that sometimes the reason why you didn't get the wisdom from your mom and dad because your mom and dad didn't apply wisdom either. Neither did they yield to understanding. We shifted from wisdom and understanding are words connected to knowledge. Remember this, we have shifted from a knowledge society to a feeling society. You all said in your generation, you all in your feelings. So we have shifted to a, I want to know about you when you meet somebody, to what you feel. Well, I feel this and I feel that. Well, the only problem with that is sometimes what you're feeling may not be what you appear. Especially when you're feeling in ignorance, meaning in darkness. You ever tried to grab a hold of something in darkness and thought you had one thing and you had another? Because ignorance means darkness, means you can't really see what you have. Anybody get my point? So I want us to get that point because why is God leading us? Because why in a time that God is talking about change, he's leading us to wisdom? Because we need to understand the tools that go along. Because number one, you ain't going to lay down your life with nobody when you don't have any understanding. When we lack understanding or when we lack knowledge, we ain't going to lay out. We don't know. Why would I do that? Because in my feelings, I have in my feelings a mechanism of self-preservation. In your feelings, you have a self-preservation, meaning it's all about you. When somebody gets your timing wrong, you're not going to forgive. You're not going to hold your peace. And some of us be like, man, let's keep going. No, we need to understand these things. Especially, man, y'all know I'm telling the truth, man. Especially when it's talk about giving instructions, man. I done seen Prophet Barber give instructions. People done told him to kiss his butt. They ain't gonna do what he say. I done seen leaders, boy, you can't, man, give instructions today. I don't believe that's God. Does it contradict what God say? And the thing about it is, we live in a society that you can get instructions from one place. That's why you got to make sure you where God sent you. Because if you where God sent you, you got to trust God. Because we're in a society today is, you can get instructions from one parent. If you don't like that, you can find another parent to give you some different instructions. That's called confusion. And the Bible says, in the latter days, people going to heave up parents after their own heart. They're going to heave up parents who will give them instructions that are in agreement with what they want. But if you have the Holy Spirit, if you have the Holy Spirit, It is to bring you into remembrance of Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, I always do those things. That's the word of God. So if you have the Holy Spirit that's bringing you into the word of God, the word says he always do those things that please who? The Father. We got to be careful that we're in a time of people that you want to hear from. Do they please you? Or do they please God? That's why I always say this. God is good. The devil's a liar. Let us know the difference. That's why that statement is made. Do we know the difference? From something that you're trying to hear to please you, or something that you want to hear that pleases God? Because a son desires to please his father. A bastard desires to please himself. That's what scriptures say. Because he cannot be chastened. He cannot be corrected. Amen? Okay, we got that. I just want to get, y'all with me? We understand, right? I just want us to have that core. Because I want us to be able to read this, but how is it relevant right now? Well, how do we see it functioning right now? Just to sit here and read the book of Proverbs and not understand how it's relevant and how it's functioning right now, that's a waste of time. Go ahead.
Verse 7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge.
Stop right there. Somebody break that down. The fear of the Lord is the beginning. And the reason I'm saying, because I love that word beginning. Beginning means entry place. So he's giving us a nugget. He's giving you a nugget according to knowledge. To fear the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. The entry place. Somebody give me just on that right there. What, anybody give me some understanding on that? Go ahead.
Come on.
She says to fear the Lord, you can't fear something that you don't understand. But when you understand who he is, you have knowledge on who he is, on who he is, right? Okay, that's good, but there's something a little deeper than that. What he's saying? Go ahead.
I was gonna say also to piggyback on roles, like the fear of the Lord. When you think about it, it's like reverence, understanding right. The magnitude of who he is, his love, but also not in the sense that he wants to destroy you, but he can destroy you. So when you understand the sovereignty of God, you understand like he should be your reference point to everything, because he is everything. So because he have knowledge to everything, that's who I should go to in fear too, like reverence.
Yeah. Amen. Hold up. I don't want to go. I'm going to keep going. I'm just wanting to. I'm just going to keep going. In that area, she's correct. In other words, to fear the Lord is the beginning, the entry point. Why? Because this is my dad. If I don't reverence him and respect him for his position and who he is, I'm not going to listen to him. Bottom line. If I don't, see, your lack of reverence to fear the Lord, if you don't fear him, and that's why, look how I say it says Lord. That's the key to the scripture. He says to fear the Lord. Lord means ruler. Y'all get what I'm saying? The key to that scripture is to fear the Lord. Because the Lord, number one, it's the beginning of all. Why? Because if you don't fear the Lord, Lord means the ruler. That he's talking, when you see that word Lord, that's position over your life. If he is Lord over my life and I don't reverence him in his position, I'm not going to, number one, if I don't reverence him, like it's like Ann said, if I don't know the magnitude of, and then like Rose said, if I don't know the magnitude of who he really is, in other words, let's say he always lied, but he my dad. Because he always lied, when he says something, I'm not going to really reverence that. So I'm not going to be in compliance with it because I don't really have doubt in what he said. But if I've studied God and I know that there is no lie in him. Amen? And he is the very essence that created the heavens and the earth and the sea and the fullness of. He is truth. He is the very essence of what truth is. So therefore, I fear him. I reverence when he speaks. And that's why, let me tell you why I know that we hate instructions. Because some of us, when God is speaking or preaching, our mind be on everything else but God. When the word comes, see, that's when you hate instructions. You hate instructions because when a pastor is preaching the gospel, which not his opinion, when he's giving the word of God, I don't see the necessity to listen. As though if I'm believing that it's him, like he's preaching of himself and not preaching and giving you the word of God. Can I get amen? Like, well, listen, if I believe it was the really word of God and I reverence him, if you touch me, I'm going to be like, leave me alone. Excuse me, don't bother me. I'm hearing what God has to say. Why? Because I understand the importance of what God has to, the instructions, because those instructions may give me, they're going to give me what I need to walk through life. Y'all better get this. It's instructions from God himself to get what I need to have victory through life. So I'm not going to let anybody disrupt me through the time when God is speaking because I'm getting instructions. But sometimes we like this. We have to wait till we get in the storm to really have a desire to get instructions. Give you a quick example. I know a marriage couple, they don't stay in Florida. They going through the high, I would call, talk to them. They know real close. And the wife really didn't want to hear nothing I had to say. You know what I'm saying? And matter of fact, the husband, like he only wanted to hear one good thing. And now he's dealing with another woman. She crying, whatever. So I talked to her today, and she now says, so what do you tell me? What do I need to do? Now she wants to hear instructions. And you know what she said to me I thought was interesting? She said, I never saw myself here. But in reality, I saw her there. Why? How did I see her there? Not because I'm psychic, not because I've got a prophetic word. I saw her there because I knew she rejected knowledge. She rejected instructions. So when one rejects instructions, why are you tripping when you see them their house tow up? Y'all, some of y'all be sitting back like, man, they were so happy. I don't see. Man, I'll be in prayer for some, even in this, for some marriage. Because I know some of you, even married couples, y'all hate instructions. But that's okay because I'm praying for you because I understand that your lack for instructions are going to bring you, and then you hate instructions, and then you want to choose who you get instructions from. Everybody look at somebody and say, you are very prideful. And the only reason you want to choose because you want instructions that are in, there you go, that's something that agrees with you. There was a prophet, they hated him because he said he never say nothing good. Yeah. They didn't like he gave instructions. We don't want him. What was that prophet? Nobody, they didn't like him. He never say nothing. He never Jeremiah. They hated him because he was like, man, he ain't going to say nothing. He's not going to prophesy. He's going to prophesy folly. He's going to prophesy. Man, don't call him, man. Because when you are a true prophet, you're not as popular as the prophets today. If you're walking in the world, you won't be as popular as the prophets who operate in the day. People love them today. Because they got a word that'll give you everything you want. So you don't want that prophet to say, you know what? God love you. But I see in you, I see you very prideful and rebellious. And you have a problem with sitting down and listening. Oh, I know that ain't God, the lying prophet. I know that ain't nobody. That brother just got problems. He hate me. No, he actually loved you and trying to give you instructions so you won't go down the road of destruction. Instructions so you won't go down the road of what? Destruction. But we don't believe that God disciplined no more. We don't believe that God correct no more. We believe, that's why this new grace message, no. The answer to that question is yes, yes, yes. Love will never stop discipline. It doesn't destroy that it does discipline. Go ahead.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, mm-hmm. But fools despise wisdom and instruction.
Everybody say amen. Go ahead.
Verse 8. My son, hear the instruction of thy father, and forsake not the law of thy mother. For they shall be an ornament of grace unto thy head, and chains about thy neck.
How many of us know That's why some of you all going to be the first generation. You are. Some of you all going to be the first generation where your children can be able to say, what is scripture, my son, hear the instructions of thy father. Because some of us in the room, God ain't trying to tell you to hear the instructions of your father, because your father, he don't have no instructions. Instructions is not, go hit that. The instructions is not, boy, you ain't tapping nothing yet. The instructions are not, boy, you ain't making that money. You better go make that money, boy. By any means necessary. See, but you all going to be, but God is creating these fathers now, say new generation. He said, who shall declare my generation? This new generation of the fathers who are men who are humble enough to receive instructions to now be able to give instructions. And your sons, now your son can now receive instructions from you. And the mother, and forsake not the laws of your mother. In other words, your mother should be able to bring the rules down in that house. Not mama talking about, girl, don't worry about daddy. Here go, I like that dress too. That you bend over and you can feel the, daddy ain't cool. You know, daddy don't want to let his little baby go. Letting you go don't mean having you dressed like a, amen. Daddy little girl should be always daddy little girl. Okay. Go ahead.
Verse 10. My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. If they say, come with us, let us lay wait for blood. Let us lurk privily for the innocent without cause. Let us swallow them up alive as the grave, and whole as though they go down into the pit. We shall find all precious substance. We shall fill our houses with spoil. Cast in thy lot among them. Let us all have one purse. My son, walk not thou in the way with them. Refrain thy foot from their path.
What do we see? Wisdom. And you know, he's giving wisdom to him, son. You know what? Let me tell you how it sounds today. Girl, you know them girls. You're not like that. Daughter, why are you hanging with them girls? You know them girls. That girl is not right. That girl is not. She always trying to creep into the club. That's how you account. When a parent, I'm using this not in reference. I'm trying to show you how a mother can give wisdom to not allowing you to be seduced by your friend to move in a direction that's contradicting the ways of your mom and dad. Amen. Some of us, everybody looking like, what? Y'all know how people, and I like how, y'all notice how I say it when he first said, my son, if sinners, what? Entice. See, that's how it does. When somebody wants to move contrary to the word of God, they want to entice you. Girl, your mama just don't want you to have no fun. Your mama old-fashioned, girl. Your mama going to, then they going to say something like, girl, your mama got you so on a tight rope. When you get out, you're going to just get loose. They got all kind of stupid stuff that the world say. Oh, because your mama loved you enough to have boundaries and rules. So when you get out the house, you're going to turn into a shown. Come on, stop playing games. Not if you have understanding that the rules come from a place of protecting you and loving you. Girl, tomorrow night we creeping out. We going out and we gonna go out to the club. Just tell your mama you're gonna be at my house. Entice. I want you to get the meat of this. To be enticed to move contrary to the word of God. Because the word of God tells you to honor your mother and father. So when somebody entices you, even leaders, authority, when somebody tries to entice you to move contrary to that, you're getting ready to shed some blood. Amen. We love the book of wisdom. Don't we love the book of Proverbs already, right? Good. Okay. Go ahead.
Verse 16. For their feet run to evil and make haste to shed blood. Surely in vain the net is spread in the sight of any bird. And they lay wait for their own blood. They lurk privily for their own lives. So are the ways of everyone that is greedy of gain, which taketh away the life of the owners thereof. Wisdom crieth without.
Hold on. Do we get that? How many of us get it? In other words, when a person doesn't value their own life, they're surely not going to value yours. And watch this. To try to take advantage of someone else is to put your own life in danger also. How many of you know if I seduce you to go rob a store, I'm putting yours and my life in danger of death? Because there's no guarantee that person under in that store doesn't have a gun. So they lead you to endanger their own life for gain. You got to watch. And this, sometimes we look at it as robbery, but anything that would cost your life to prison, people trying to get you to move in a way that for that gain, to make that money. They're going to try to get you to move in a way to make that money that's going to put your life in danger. He said they set the trap. He said the birds see the net trap. In other words, you got to be able to see the trap through the wisdom of your father. You know what? He's instructing a son to watch. Oh, man, this thing is so. You know what I get? See, when we can't receive instructions or knowledge, we ignore those who have been there before us. See, I use Father Barber. I would love for me, man, some of y'all, I would be at the feet of that brother, absorbing the knowledge of what it takes to be able to stand through adversity. But you won't, many of you all, you won't. Because the fact is, you don't like knowledge. Or maybe you just don't think you ever gonna go through some adversity and dealing with relationships and things like that. But see, if I knew somebody who had already gone through it and came through it and know how to love, why would I be trying to come on? That's foolishness. He's talking about it right here. That's why it's a father giving advice to a son and telling the son, if you listen to me, you will see the trap. As the birds see the net, you will see it. Because I'm telling you ahead of time that this is not the road you... Wisdom causes you... How many of y'all know this? That knowledge will cause you to see something before you go down that road. I can tell... How many of y'all are familiar with Miami? How many of y'all are familiar with Miami? If I told you to go to two... If I told you to go to 620 Northwest 167th Street and there's a building there, because what you are familiar with, you're going to be able to see yourself going there before you even get am I right or wrong. All I did was give you the knowledge. I used to use an example like this. If you saw a nurse and a biologist, if a nurse and a biologist was walking down the street and a frog leaped out, which one going to holler? The nurse. Because the biologist, when she see a frog, she sees it deeper than that. She knows what's really there. Knowledge causes you to see. There are people who love to read. Why? Because they can experience something whatever going there. I've never been to Paris, but I can read and partake of Paris without even going there, because reading, the knowledge takes me there. Why don't we understand this when it comes to knowledge? Like, that's what he's talking about, Proverbs. Understanding this when it comes to life. Why do we have to keep repeating the same old cycle? My mama got pregnant when she was young. Her mama got pregnant when she was young. My mama was in a failed relationship. The only reason you're not going to be in a failed relationship is because you exceed why? Somewhere along the line, God inserted some knowledge. It's not going to be your desire. It's not going to be your will. It's going to be God inserting something new in you to handle the different situation different. But if it's not inserted with you, you won't handle it just like your mama did. And you'll get the same. Even though you said, no, I'm not going to be like my mama. I'm not going to be like, you're going to be sitting right in that divorce court like your mama. In church, the same way. Because women like, no, you ain't got to submit to. Oh, submitting mean to me. Submitting don't mean doing everything. Submitting don't mean, you know, I can tell. I can go off and I express. And because you fail to read the manual and you don't understand what submission really means, you think you submitting because you brought them dinner, but when you brought it, you had an attitude. You do what's asked of you, but you do it with the wrong attitude. And God saying, and God ain't even honoring what you're doing. Because he knows the intent of your heart is wicked. I wish he'd get up and get his. But see, if you read the instructions, you would understand that you would do it with a joyful spirit. You would do it because it's an act of love. Not an act of obligation. Amen? But we got a society that says, I don't need such. And then you want to listen to these women live movement, and they're going to try to, and you got all this inside of you. So now when you are challenged, God says you got an F. And you mad at God, he gave you an F, because you saying, God, well, if he was more like this, if he did this, God, he should do things that make me want to do that. God said, you didn't do things to make me do what I want, what I did. Show me what you did to make me die for you. Show me how good you were to make me die for you. Then I understand what you're talking about. Well, I'll do it if he do something nice for me. I like this book, Proverbs. Y'all like it too, right? Because you can get to dig in. Because I'm learning. I want to learn. I'm learning. I've been reading it. So I know that you can't go tit for tat. I know you got to dig in. And number one, don't be upset when it starts digging. It digging me too. Just be in a position to learn. Get instructions. You know what? Some people that God found hard to deal with? People who thought they were already wise and people who thought they was rich. People who thought they was always wise because they couldn't get no instruction because they think they knew everything. And people who are already rich stuff, they had everything already, so they ain't need nothing. Your money don't make you. Your money, your degrees don't make you wise in God's eyes.
It's foolishness.
It's foolishness to God. So you say, I don't have to read this. I got this. The problem with some of us is how we got it was those techniques and methods we used when we was in the world. Woo. There's only one problem with that. In the world it didn't work, and you're going to find out in church it don't work either. I know, because you be hearing them, you know, when they have those little religious conference, girl, that's your man, girl, you better lay it on him, girl, you better, that's your man, make sure he don't want no other woman, make sure you wear him out. Let me tell you something, let me blow that out the water. You laying it on him physically is not going to kill that lust and perverted spirit that's in him. Now you loving him like God will cause him to desire to seek God. I didn't say you love him going to change, but it can cause him to seek God for the answer to that situation. Amen? Because that's the world out here, church. Man, girl, when you get married, you got to put it on him, girl. And I'm not saying don't make love to your husband. I'm just saying don't think, I ain't saying that don't put it on him either. Put it on him. I ain't saying that. I ain't saying that. I'm just saying that's not the ingredients to keep them. It's how many of y'all know, I'm trying to get you to see how we phrase things. And how they can be phrased can be wrong. Amen? And we gotta be deeper than that. Go ahead. Amen.
Verse 20. Wisdom crieth without. She uttereth her voice in the streets. She crieth in the chief place of concourse, in the opening of the gates. In the city she uttereth her words, saying, how long, ye simple ones, will ye love simplicity? And the scorners delight in their scorning.
You know what I think about that when I hear that? When Jesus said, how long have I dwelt with you, ye of little faith? He's saying, I'm giving you the word to get the right outcome. But you don't want to hear it. How long will I have to dwell with you before you begin to understand what I'm saying to you will produce what you really want? When will you begin to understand that my word is what you need to produce the best outcome? Amen? Jesus just said it like, oh, ye a little faith. How long? That's all he's saying. Jesus, he went, how long? How long will you not find my word the wisdom that you need to get success? How long will you continue to do it your way and not heed to instructions? Go ahead.
How long will you simple ones love simplicity, and you scorners delight in your scorning, and you fools hate knowledge? Turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you. I will make known my words unto you.
Yeah, y'all notice that he said, everybody say, repent. He says, turn to my reproof. He says, I'm reproving you by trying to stop you from going in the wrong direction, by giving you knowledge. Do you all know every Sunday? What is church for every Sunday? Sunday evening, Sunday morning. That's all God. He's giving us knowledge to reprove for, so we can, if we find ourselves to repent, it's come on. To change, that's what change is. Change is to regain, to be reproved. He said, how long? He said it right here. Look what he said right here. He says, and fools hate knowledge. Why do you keep hating the knowledge that I'm giving you that's going to cause you to turn from the disaster that you're going into? Stop blaming him. Stop blaming her. Turn from, receive the knowledge that I'm giving you. Come unto me. You know, heavy laden, I'll give you rest. He said, I'm your rest place. Turn. Turn. And that's what he said. When you, he said, when you, and I love how he said, he says, because it says in the New International Version, when he says turn, 23, he says repent at my rebuke. When you hear the word of God, repent. Turn and receive the knowledge. And guess what? You will stop getting those consequences. Look at somebody say turn. Some of y'all have heard me say it. I'll say, how many, I ask people this all the time, especially when I'm dealing with a couple. When I hear people going through things, I ask them this question. Do you want your next 5 years to be like your last 5 years? And someone be like, no, never, no. Then you want something different, you got to do something different. Renew your mind. Because your last 5 years has something to do with the way you were thinking. Even the drama that you had in your last 5 years came from, they were what? Access points to your thinking process. So if I'm arguing a lot with my wife, if I'm fighting with my friends, if I'm quitting on my job every time I get a job because I can't tolerate anything, then stop blame. This is what we do. We blame everybody instead of fighting that thinking process where that thinking, finding, there's a way we think that's giving access for the enemy to get that outcome. Amen? Now, I'm not saying the way we think that the things happen in our life are not real. The Bible says, out of heart flows the issues of life. How many of us have gone through some issues? And some of those issues have formed our thinking pattern. Amen? Some of us, how we see sex formed it. How we deal with money formed it. How we deal with family formed it. But say, everybody say, but we got to get to that place to renew our mind. We know that way of thinking is messed up. We done built up that. Some of us, we got what we call strongholds. What's a stronghold? That thought path, that thought path, that area in your life is locked in. You just think you right. You think, let's say we have someone like, man, I don't trust no man. I ain't going to never trust no man, whatever. So that hurt point on where you got that thought pattern is so locked in, it's a fortress. And when God preached words about trusting people, you just don't, pop, pop. You're hitting that wall, pop, pop, pop. But I'm so glad that God is a God that keep watering and planting and going to break down that stronghold. He said, walk around the wall 7 times. Because some things you're going to have to patiently wait for it to tumble down. I'm going to touch this issue and then we're going to go on and finish this up because we almost finished. Because we're not. Listen. Some people wonder why their wife or deal with, and some wives didn't tell them. Because this is what come to my mind, what God is showing me. The wife was sexually molested. She has areas when it comes to sex that's difficulty. Amen? In that area, God tells the husband, dwell with her according to knowledge. I want you to learn her in this area. What is he telling? He's telling the written epistle, which is the husband, learn her, dwell with her according to knowledge. Because he says, where sin abound, grace abound much more. He said, that stronghold is a place where sin has built up a fortress. But grace, what is grace? Y'all got to get this. I see this thing in my spirit while I'm explaining. Grace is unmerited, undeserved behavior in that area that she's rejecting you, despising you. Instead of getting angry, you're being patient and long-suffering. You're dwelling with the issue according to knowledge. And the way that you are being is tearing down the wall. Though in my flesh, I'm going through something. But in my spirit, I'm going to have to cuddle up with her tonight. Because I understand we married, yes, everything. But this thing needs to be broken. Let me tell you something. Let me tell you from experience. And not in that area right there. My wife would tell you, she would say, well, I never forget. My wife would, and I can tell you this because God is delivering me. My wife, if we had a little argument, this was just, she would go off. She would be so angry. And I'm like, why this girl so angry over something? I mean, just go in rage. Just be angry, angry, angry. So one day I saw God dwelling with her according to knowledge. I'm like, what's going on? And God said, when she was 4. So I said, babe, what happened when you was 4? And she clammed up and she ain't say nothing. And I knew it was God then. Because when I said 4, she went quickly and withdrew. And then not that time then, I impressed. I found out later when she was 4, her dad and her mom was fighting and a knife was drawn and blood was splashing and got on her. So she was caught in a room full of rage between her mom and dad, people she loved, and she saw blood and she saw the rage and it affected her at 4. To when somebody come at her or if she even thought she was threatful, she would be willing to put up that guard quickly. And there were times that, and I'm not telling you this to show my, I'm not telling you this to reveal my wife, I'm telling you this to show you something. And there were times, because I have my own issue, there were times my wife get mad, and I mean one time she came and she just threw the food, bam. There was one time she got mad and she like, pop, and scratched my face. And I could not hit her. All I could do was love on her. And God, I don't get me wrong, I walk out the house and I'm like, oh, God, I go, and I had to go, I'm going to a meeting and it's God's in my face. And they ask me what's going on. I'm covering her. I'm not uncovering her now because I'm giving you a process. She's not that one. I'm talking about her hurt. And see, God gave me her because he was going to give me the love to be able to bring her out of that situation. I wish I could tell you it was 1 year, 2 years. But in loving her and cutting her, and the thing about it was her father would abandon. So she was afraid. So when her mom would go there, he would just leave. So she was like, so God says, no, you got to stay there, stay there. And I never forget, around our 7th year, she rolled over and she said, babe, I know there's nothing you wouldn't do for me. And it never happened anymore. God says, the people God match with you, friends, we don't know how to love. We don't understand that God didn't match perfect people with you. He doesn't give you perfect friends. But he gave you a perfect love in him to teach you how to love in places that you wouldn't know how to love, that they might be free. And in that area, there are areas that God used my wife to love me through. And I saw it. There were areas that that just the way she would deal with things, and even how she is now, because she is so, even in the, when the enemy throw darts, lustful thoughts, anything coming at me, it's funny how I can see, I can sit, like I never forget, man, I'm gonna have, it, the enemy was coming like full war. But the kind of wife he gave me, I was able to tell her. And I remember one time I let the thoughts go for a while. I'm like, man. And I was noticing when I was getting stressed, those thoughts would be like, and I found my mind like going into sexual thoughts. I'm like, boom, boom. And I was starting to find myself resting in those thoughts. And God began to show me. He showed me, said, and I'm I could be transfigured out. He showed me, what did he show me? He said, soft porn. He told me soft porn. I was like, what? And he began to deal with me. And then after he began to deal with me, he began to minister to me. Because, and then he said, tell your wife. So I laid on, I told my wife, I said, babe, I cheated on you. I said, yeah, I said, I did it in my mind. Because I believe the word of God all the way. See, if you believe the word all the way, you got to believe it. See, we like, well, I didn't really cheat. No, in God's eyes, if you lust up on another woman, you cheated. But see, he gave me the kind of wife that I can say that to. And she sat there and she gave me a hug, and we were, now I said, can you pray? And she prayed with me. See, you have to understand is that there can be no hiding places. Hiding places calls for a lack of growth. But if God gave you the person, see, y'all understand something. I don't, transparency, people like, wow, because you got to be transparent. Because number one, when you deliver, because God delivered, he has delivered from me, he has took that from me, I was like, boom. The bottom line is, but the reality of the situation is that the enemy is constantly throwing darts, and if you grab a hold to one, next thing you know, you're meditating on it a lot. And the enemy is always trying to get you to find a place for your head to rest other than Christ. Sometimes perverted thoughts are a place to rest. Sometimes TV is a place to rest. Sometimes going to play ball is a place to rest. Amen. Sometimes anger is a place to rest. Samson found Delilah. And sometimes we like them place to rest because nobody else can see. See, the enemy was funny. You know, the enemy told me one time, when I was going through that battle, he said, you can't have both worlds. He said, because nobody don't see you. I said, you are a liar. He told me because nobody can see my thoughts, I can have a, I can always, I can meditate on what he wanted me to do, think of, and still preach the word of God. I said, no, that don't work that way. Because the word says fresh water and salt water can't come out the same fountain. I love Davon's name, Mr. Transparent, because transparency brings growth and development. And when you free, or you know the one who free you, I say follow me as I follow Christ. You not follow me as I follow me. I follow Christ. And my life should be a testimony that Christ is well able. If anything, it should be a testimony that God can take the foolish things. I'm the first one to say, God, you use, you good. Because I give all glory to God. I'm not delusional in believing that I'm all that good. I just know he all that good. So, in that situation, I want us to understand. Are we getting this? I want us to understand and be able to digest it and get it down, all right? Is that it? That was, no, we got to read a little bit more and we finish.
Verse
24.
Because I have called and ye refused, I have stretched out my hand, and no man regarded. But ye have sent anon all my counsel, and will none of my reproof. I also will laugh at your calamity.
How many of you know that after a while, God gonna turn you over to what you, if you won't take counsel or the instructions, you gonna get it. I've seen it happen. He'll turn you over.
Go ahead.
I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock you when your fear cometh. When your fear cometh as desolation, and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish cometh upon you, then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer.
He said, they going to come, but after they, I'm going to tell you something right now. Everybody in this room will be like, thank you for grace. No. That's what I'm telling you something. Because we are in a season that if you call because of grace, God, because why? Death is not waiting for you. Boy, grace is power. Y'all understand. If you ain't ever understand grace, get it right here. Because this right here, judgment was when they called, he's like, bam, you got, come on, when you touch that thing and God didn't tell you, you dropped dead. Judgment went in the law. If you broke it, you died. In grace, because Jesus paid the price.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, my God. Amen. Because Christ paid the price. Death is not waiting for you, but discipline is. And just because death not waiting on you doesn't mean that you might not find yourself in a child support office. Can I get an amen? Does not mean that you might not find yourself with HIV. See, y'all got people fooling y'all. I be listening to some of these preachers and some of them, and I'm not throwing anybody out there, but they be talking about grace, grace, grace. But let me tell you something. Your disobedience in God, yes, death is not waiting for you, but consequences can come with your disobedience. And they lying into my, and then they make it seem like, okay, if you be disobedient, whatever, God has paid it all, and God is not going to destroy you. No, he's going to discipline you. And in your discipline, watch this, it is not God giving you the HIV. It is your lack of obeying God that puts you on a road that produces HIV. Amen? And if they try to tell you because of grace that if you start going crazy or making the wrong decision, Jesus paid it all, there ain't nothing going to happen. They lying to you. Matter of fact, life itself will tell you they lying to you. Because the bottom line is, has anybody got careless in a certain area and found yourself have to deal with that situation? You knew you were saved, but you had to deal with that situation. Yes. Get careless with your money. You sitting in the dark. God love you, but you in that dark. Why? Because you thought that dress was better than a light bill. And to try to preach a message that, you know what God against. Yeah. Be obedient to his word. See, we're gonna get past. Grace takes you to life. Amen? And you got grace in life. You never eliminate grace, because I do this because of grace, because without grace, death would be there. Amen? But when I disobey the word of God, there are consequences. And to try to preach that there are not, that's not true. Just because death is not waiting for me, that doesn't mean it by, because I'm not trying to be funny, but the man that died in the hotel room, what was his name? Tim's. That brother can preach. Man of God. He died, but he died in that hotel room. Amen. Watch this. You got people losing their wives. What's his name? Be just singing. Ty Tribute. He lost his wife. We done got so crazy to believe that, well, that wasn't really a big deal. Really? To lose your family is not a big deal? To operate in sin and lose your family, so now losing your family is not a big deal? Have we gone crazy? Oh, I could just get another one of those. Bro, I'm going to pray for you, because that's not really how that goes. God don't throw, somebody said, well, how do we know that's not how really that goes? Because God ain't in the business of throwing souls away. He's not in the business of treating souls like trash. He's not in the business of making that woman feel like she's not relevant. I don't know where you got that from. Maybe you got that from America. But that ain't in the scripture. Amen? Go ahead and finish it. Let's go. Finish it.
Verse 28. Then they shall call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me.
Y'all ever know when people are in trouble, they be fast? You ever know when we in trouble, we be fasting early in the morning? When you're going through something, boy, you ain't got to tell you get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. You be up at 3 o'clock, Lord Jesus. Lord, please. Lord, please, Jesus. Please, Lord. And so he said he gonna seek, didn't he say he's going to seek me early in the morning? They, you know, when you're not going anything, you be like, you be in the bed trying to do a 3-minute prayer. Hallelujah. But boy, let things start getting crazy. Baby, what's up? I don't need to eat. Seeking them early in the morning when consequences come, boy, they'll drive you to your knees. Anybody been there? On your knee. Come on, y'all know. You're losing weight. I don't care. I'm fasting. I need to hear from God. You be nice to everybody too. Because you be trying to hear from God. God, get me out this mess I done put myself in. I'm so glad God merciful. How many of you know if you didn't die in it, mean lose your life, that was mercy? If you was in a wheelchair for the rest of your life, that's mercy. If you became a paraplegic, that's mercy. Because if you mess around and took your last breath and you wasn't in, you gonna like, you might be in trouble. Go ahead.
Verse 29. For that they hated knowledge.
They hated what?
They hated knowledge.
Now he said they hated knowledge, so they must have been fools. Because it said a fool hate knowledge. And he said when we hate knowledge, we refuse to receive instructions. And when we refuse to receive instructions, we refuse to alter the direction we're going in. Yeah. How many of us getting it? I want us to get one, because one, and he's talking to, remember now he started out talking, he went into talking to a son who he was giving directions to about people trying to make that fast money. Right? Hanging with their friends, being enticed to move in a direction to shed blood. And I'm going to tell y'all something. I know it says gain here, and it's about money, but there are situations like that where people, your friends can entice you to do something, to move in sexual immorality. They can entice you to slander and belittle people, to shed innocent blood. And God, he be warning you and I about, don't talk about your sisters. Don't slander, don't backbite. And I know God be saying to us, how long? When you gonna keep it closed? And when it get us in trouble, when you done got fired, or you know, like, and God be like, I told you to keep it closed. You know what I believe when he says the Father don't hear me laughing? Means that God lets you go ahead and get fired. Because how many know that it's God, he is still God sovereign. He can give you grace in it, but he lets you start feeling the consequence. It reminds me, I know that time I told y'all the story where the man jumped off the Empire State Building halfway down. He said, Lord, forgive me. God said, I forgive you, but I'll see you in a minute. You're going to have to deal with them consequences. But you're going to heaven, but you're going to have to deal with them consequences. Some of us need to stop the direction. Many of us in this room, God is starting us out with wisdom, and you desiring change. Some of you all, you're coming because you want change. And God is telling you your change. You have to start listening to get change. You have to be willing to receive instructions to get change. Amen. You got to stop going by your own thought patterns to get change. Seek wise counsel to get change. Change comes from you fighting against your own thought pattern. Some of us, I don't know, I hear this in the spirit. Some of us, we have, this is a strange thing with God, by the way. The spirit of entitlement, that's a dangerous spirit. Entitlement. I believe I deserve this. You don't know, I done all this. Mm-mm. I believe, God, you better do something. All I've been going to church. I ain't slept with nobody for 9 months. I've been coming every day doing my Hail Marys when I walk through the church. I've been nice to people. I even sung one time in the choir for you, God. So I know you're going to give me my man. And then you know what happened? Somebody get married and they get aggravated. And they get frustrated. And then they, and please don't let it be somebody who was came after them. That ain't God. I know that ain't. They gonna first they're gonna start slandering because they're gonna believe ain't no way in the world God can do them before God can give them a husband. And God be like, you don't even know if God gonna have you even get a husband. And the problem with some of y'all is you ain't learned how to be content with yourself yet. Man, God, how you opening up these jobs to people? I hate my job. And Sister Bobo coming in there talking about I love my job and God is doing this and God done blessed me with this and that. And then God be like, because you don't have no loyalty in you. I can't trust you. So I'm going to put you there and leave you there until I can finish training you. Be trying to conquer up dreams, God telling me to leave. I saw a dream that I was inside the store and the store closed. Yeah, that means stay inside. I was interpreting, I know you was, but it means stay inside. I had a dream, I opened the door for somebody and a bird flew through. I think God was letting me know that means he flew in. Stay inside, amen? Y'all know people be making up crazy stuff, man, be coming up with crazy interpretations. I had a dream, he helped me outside of my car, so I know he got to be my husband. He helped me outside my car. Maybe God is saying he's going to help you with your walk in life. Amen? Listen, get your mind on the things of God. Proverbs, finish it up. Go ahead, finish.
Verse 29. Mm-hmm. For that they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord.
They hated knowledge and they did not choose the fear of the Lord. And we found out in verse 7. Hold up. Wait a minute, not 7. If they say, no, so hold up, we found out in verse 7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. I want y'all to remember this. They entered in wrong. We found out in verse, remember now in Proverbs 1, verse 7 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. But it says at the end, they hated knowledge in what?
And the fear of the Lord.
And the fear of the Lord. They did not fear the Lord. They did not reverence God, so they did not reverence what he had to say. That was it, right?
Verse 30. They would none of my counsel. They despise all of my reproof.
They wanted no counsel from God, and they despise God trying to correct them, reprove them. How many of you all know when you and I start walking in the wrong way, God is trying to reprove you. And he will send people to counsel you. I'm going to tell you, I have found myself in situations, and I can be honest. Even when I was, it's funny because you know what, I remember when I was not saved, and people, you know, how many of y'all ever been in a situation when you knew of God, but you ain't really was serving God, and you'll be walking in the store and somebody talk to you about God? Anybody ever been there? You'll walk in the library, it's 150 people in that library, but they come to you and say, God love you. God is trying to get your attention because your next decision is about to take you down a course you're not going to like. But because we refuse counsel, y'all understand, when God begins to use people to talk to you or say things to you, when you ignore that, you're about to head down a road that you're not going to like. He said they refused counsel, didn't he? And they refused his reproving. They did not want him to correct. When you don't want God to correct you because you're like, no. I don't like that. I don't want to hear from that person. I don't like that person. In other words, I think the biggest thing about it is that we don't understand that God is only doing that because he loves you. How many of us know this? We're going to be real up here, right? I heard the woman of God, I was laughing today when I heard you do prayers and worship. I heard you say, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He what? Leadeth me besides the still water. You know what the problem with us when it comes to, to fear the Lord is the beginning of all knowledge. To reverence God, sometimes we think we know more than God. Sometimes we think we know what's best for us than God. But if the Lord is your shepherd, and you shall not want, and he leadeth you beside the still waters, he leads you down the pathway of righteousness for his name's sake, then the question is, are you leading your life, or is the shepherd? Amen. And when, that's why we got to present our body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable as our reasonable service. Surrender to, if you really want God, how many of y'all really want change? How many really want change? Then surrender. Release the reins of your life. How do I do that? Submit to the word of God. Tell your father, I'm ready to listen now. Tell me, where shall I go? Tell me what you desire of me. Lead me down the path of righteousness for your name's sake. That when people see me, they glorify you. Because the problem is, as long as you are leading according to your emotions and your feelings and what you want, you're not going to get change. Just because you get a different guy, just because you get a different girl, just because you get a different job, that's not change. We should have learned that when we elected our president. Just because he was a different color did not mean that was change. He was no different. He is no different. He operates in the same system. He operates in a satanic, demonic system. Y'all know that, right? The United States system is a satanic, demonic system. It does not it does not desire, neither does it want to be in compliance with the word of God. God even used him to show that he has evolved beyond the system of God when it comes to covenant. But we think change is, you know how many people tell me, well, man, I know my life going to be different. My life going to be different. If Michelle, if I could just, I'm going to Atlanta. If you ever had somebody tell you that, I'm tired of Miami. And then you let, they be up there here, they call you with the same old drama. Man, I can't deal with Miami. I'm going to Georgia where it's quiet. Relocating does not bring change unless it's an atmosphere. The Bible says when two or three are gathered, he is in the midst. In the atmosphere of God, it ushers in change. Why? Not an atmosphere where people are going religiously crazy. An emotional, hear what I'm about to say to you. An emotional movement of people hollering and screaming does not bring change. Unless God is walking in the presence and delivering people. Everybody understand? But other than that, change comes from hearing the word of God. I don't have to lay hands on you to deliver you. God can speak a word to me to speak directly to your situation. And if you can receive instructions and comply with that word of God, the shackle's going to be broken. They'll be broken. Some of us have sat here. How many of us sat here and were dealing with relationships and God spoke to you? Was like, I hear you, Lord. And you knew he was talking to you. Don't lie. Anybody ever sat here over the years, you say, and you knew, and God was talking about relationships, said, oh, he's talking about me. Okay. If you received the instructions and you applied them, you would have got the reward from them. If God started preaching about forgiveness, and forgive, and some of us, and God start talking about mama and daddy and talking about forgiveness. If you go home and call your mom, if you go home and apply what you receive and you begin to put the effort in to ask or to move in forgiveness, guess what you're going to get? A harvest of change. But if you leave out here and you harden your heart and says, well, if they don't say nothing to me, I'm not going to say nothing to them. If they don't call me, now, why are you expecting change and you will not move in compliance of the word? The Bible says, leave your gift at the altar. In that scripture, the person who left their gift was not the one who did the wrong. So what does God say to you? You don't have to be the one who do the wrong to bring the reconciliation. You just have to be the one that's spiritually in tune. I don't want to hear another person say, it was a good sermon. I want to hear people say, I received from the sermon and I began to apply it. And guess what? I replied to which, oh son, hear the word of God. Understand the instructions I give unto you. Receive those instructions and apply those instructions and eat from the wisdom of God and receive the blessings of the Lord. But to come to church tomorrow, it was a good word, and walk out of here and forget it, there will be no change in your life. You are on an emotional roller coaster. You just feel good. The problem is not solved. You just feel good because you heard something that sounded good, but you're not willing to implement it. And sometimes implementing something, it can be difficult because you got to die. Well, how they gonna look at me if I go tell them I'm sorry? What if they don't, here come the enemy. What if they don't receive it? What if my mama rejects me? You're not doing it based on their response. You're doing it because you want to be obedient to love. You want to be obedient to the one you reverence, God. You're doing it because you want to be in compliance. You want to please God. If they don't grab a hold to it, that's on them. Your desire is to please God. That's why you're doing it. Father, I'm doing it. I reverence you as my Father. You are the great I am. You are the one who saved me and delivered me. You are my resurrection. You are the beginning. You are the Alpha and Omega. You are my God. You are God all. You created the heavens and sprinkled the stars in the sky. Come on. You are the one who set the sun. You're the one who gave. You sent your son and getting through his grace. You have called, given me eternal life. Come on, God. If you want me to, I'll go do it to please you. And if they reject me and despise me, God, then teach me how to love them still. Amen. That's it.
Verse 30 again. They would none of my counsel. They despise all of my reproof. Therefore shall they eat of the fruit of their own way and be filled with their own devices.
For don't nobody want to do that. You do not want to eat of the fruit of your own way. It's rotten. Look at somebody and say, please, do not eat of the fruit of your own way. All right.
For the turning away of the simple shall slay them, and the prosperity of the fools shall destroy them. But whoever hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from fear of evil.
He said the safe place is to be in compliance with the word of God. Amen. Listen.
Say something. Let me finish. I want to say something.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. I was just like sitting here and like, I believe like God is like, you know, putting a word like on my heart. Because my heart is like really heavy when I was listening to Apostle and reading a chapter. And I feel like God is saying like there's like a heavy like spirit of pride on us, like on some of his people, and the pride comes from not wanting to submit to anyone else besides God himself. Like God is saying that there are some people in here who says, I don't have to listen to the leadership, I don't have to listen to my brother, my sister, I don't have to listen to my parents or to authority. I got my own relationship with God, and I'm not going to listen to anyone else unless I hear from God directly. And God said that that's the spirit of pride, and he says that sometimes he does speak through other people, and that you need to humble yourself and listen and test the spirit of the people who's speaking to you to see if what they're saying is true or not. And because he says that he's not going to listen to you when you cry out to God and says, okay, God, like, I'm not going to listen to Apostle. I'm not going to listen to Prophet Barbara. I'm not going to listen to my brothers and sisters. God, you speak to me. God says, I'm not going to speak to you. I'm going to allow you to humble yourself by submitting to those who I've sent to you to speak my word to you. And like he gave me like an example, like, let's say 95 South. You know, at this time of night, 11 o'clock, it gets really like heavy with traffic. And let's say someone traveled down 95 and they got stuck in the traffic and they call someone else who they don't have to travel that way and say, hey, you guys, you know, I-95 South is really crowded. There's an accident or there's just that normal congestion. Don't go to 95. Take another route. And you may say, well, you know what? I'm not going to listen to this instruction. I'm going to wait until God tell me. And then God's not going to tell you because he sent someone to you to tell you in advance. And then you go and you get stuck in the traffic. God is saying, do not despise the chastisement or the correction or the instruction of those who have went before you. And in the video that we watched earlier, in the video, the guy was saying that the book of Proverbs is not a book of the law. You know, the law is the Torah, you know, the first five books. But Proverbs is in the middle of the Bible, and that's the book of wisdom. And it's not a list of thou shalt do this and thou shalt not do that. So if you're looking for God himself to be saying things to you, Proverbs is not the book where God himself is speaking. It's the book of where Solomon and, like it was mentioned, other artists who have experience in life, they've written proverbs about wisdom for our sake, for the generations after them. And there's also an example God was showing me in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Paul's talking to married couples, and he says, I say this, not the Lord, but I say this unto you. It is better for, you know, you to be single than for you to be married. For when you're married, you have more cares in the world. And if you're looking for God himself to speak to you, sometimes, like Paul said, I'm saying this, not God, but God has given Paul the wisdom to be able to make, you know, decrees like that. So God is just really telling us, do not despise it when people give you instructions, because wisdom and instruction is a gift from God. He could be speaking to you through someone else.
On that note, I'm gonna have Devon pray us out so we can